In 1988, at the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, Dr. John Martin spoke what is arguably the most famous quote from any marine chemist. "Give me half a tanker of iron, and I'll give you an ice age." While this claim may sound like a total joke when first hearing it, the idea is backed with real evidence. It is one of many ideas that involve artificially removing large amounts of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and sequestering it to slow the rate of climate change. But how could a tanker full of iron be enough to alter our planet and put an end to global warming? In the last video, I introduced the topic of geoengineering as a way to artificially cool the Earth to combat global warming. There are two main paths to achieving this, the first being solar radiation management, and the second being greenhouse gas removal. If you want to learn more about how humanity could scatter incoming sunlight and cool the Earth, check out the first video in this three-part series. In this part, we will explore some of the ideas scientists have for removing carbon dioxide by using the world's largest carbon reservoir, the ocean. Don't forget to subscribe and click that notification bell so you don't miss the third part of the series, where we'll dive into the costs and uncertainties of these geoengineering strategies. Let's start by taking a look at ocean iron fertilization and seeing how it could change the atmosphere. While the ocean may appear empty from the surface, it is in fact teeming with microscopic creatures known as plankton. These plankton can be divided into two categories, phytoplankton, which act like miniature plants, and zooplankton, which act like miniature animals. The phytoplankton are what we want to focus on, as they partake in photosynthesis, taking in sunlight and carbon dioxide to grow and multiply. However, for plankton to grow, they need more than just sunshine and CO2. Just like terrestrial plants, many nutrients such as nitrate, phosphate, and other trace elements are required for healthy growth and reproduction. If the conditions are right, the plankton in these waters will begin a massive bloom, quickly using up most of the nutrients until there aren't enough left to support such a large population. This ends the bloom and causes the dead plankton to slowly sink into the deep ocean, carrying with them all the carbon they packed into their cells during their lives. While nitrate and phosphate are relatively abundant in the oceans, there are some regions like the Southern Ocean where we would expect to see much more plankton than we actually do. These high nutrient, low chlorophyll regions are limited by the availability of one trace metal, iron. If the waters here were enriched in iron, it would trigger a rapid growth of phytoplankton, which could theoretically pull tons of extra CO2 from the air, cooling the planet. And unlike many geoengineering strategies that are primarily tested on computer models, ocean iron fertilization has actually been tested in real life. In October 1993, the first artificial iron fertilization experiment, Iron X1, was launched just south of the Galapagos Islands. Over the 10-day experiment, a 64 square kilometer patch of ocean was fertilized with 443 kilograms of iron. Immediately, researchers saw phytoplankton populations explode in the waters near the iron source, proving that simply adding iron to the water could in fact create an artificial bloom. 12 more experiments were conducted over the next two decades, all of which confirmed the original theory that iron additions could cause phytoplankton growth. But did these experiments actually sequester carbon dioxide? Surprisingly, only one of the 13 experiments, IFEX, saw an increase in carbon sinking into the deep ocean. The other 12 did not. But why? Where were the sinking plankton going if not the deep ocean? Well, once plankton start to sink into deeper, darker waters, they're subject to a host of mechanisms with the intent to break them down. Our zooplankton from earlier will graze on these sinking phytoplankton, respiring their carbon as carbon dioxide, which bubbles back to the surface. This stops a lot of this carbon from actually reaching the depths needed for long-term sequestration. But then why did IFEX actually manage to get carbon into the deep ocean? Perhaps it was the larger scale with an area of 167 square kilometers, or the time frame taking place over 36 days. Whatever the reason, a lot more research is needed to determine whether or not ocean iron fertilization is a real solution to global warming. But what if there was a way to pull carbon from the atmosphere while at the same time addressing ocean acidification? Ocean alkalinity enhancement is another greenhouse gas removal strategy that involves removing tons of dissolved CO2 from ocean water. As you may already know, the oceans have absorbed enormous amounts of carbon dioxide over the last 200 years, stabilizing humanity's emissions, but at a cost to its pH balance. When dissolved in water, carbon dioxide undergoes hydrolysis, creating carbonic acid, driving down the ocean's pH and harming sensitive ecosystems like coral reefs. By removing dissolved CO2 from the ocean, it can not only allow the ocean to dissolve more from the atmosphere, but also make the ocean less acidic. One compound that researchers believe could do such a thing is the mineral olivine, found naturally in Earth's crust. Olivine is mainly composed of magnesium silicate. When this mineral dissolves in seawater, it reacts with carbon dioxide and water to form magnesium ions, silicic acid, an incredibly weak acid that is found naturally in seawater, and bicarbonate ions. This effectively removes CO2 from the surrounding water and buffers the pH with bicarbonate ions, simultaneously sequestering carbon and reversing ocean acidification. In the best case scenario, 1.25 tons of CO2 can be sequestered per ton of olivine, meaning that we would need enormous amounts of olivine to make a dent in our carbon budget. But how would we deliver tons of minerals into the ocean? The olivine would need to be ground into a fine powder in order for it to properly dissolve into the seawater instead of just sinking to the ocean floor. Using climate models, the ideal grain size for this powder was found to be about 1 micrometer in diameter, about the size of an average bacterial cell. Grinding massive amounts of olivine into dust requires a huge amount of energy, which will most likely produce additional carbon dioxide in the process. This would then have to be dispersed into the open ocean, either by ship or coastal sources, further increasing the carbon cost of such a project. Even so, the double-edged idea of ocean alkalinity enhancement, addressing both climate change and ocean acidification, makes it one of the most attractive geoengineering ideas to date. As I stated in the last video, the only reason that these controversial ideas are even a possibility at all is because humanity has neglected to act in time to address the climate crisis. While this field is innovative and promising, tampering with Earth's oceans could open up a whole host of unforeseen problems in the deep ocean. Much more research into ocean iron fertilization and ocean alkalinity enhancement will be needed if we are to even consider using these strategies in our arsenal against rising global temperatures. Additionally, greenhouse gas removal is not and should not be an excuse for industries and governments to continue to burn fossil fuels and delay a sustainable transition. As stated in the most recent IPCC report, some sort of negative emission strategies will be needed to keep humanity from crossing the 1.5 degree C threshold. These geoengineering strategies can only be used in conjunction with aggressive emission reductions to try to lower Earth's CO2 levels as quickly as possible. While the idea of engineering our oceans may seem impossible at first thought, it has the very real potential to be a valuable tool in our fight against the climate crisis. Thank you for sticking around to the end. Comment your thoughts on greenhouse gas removal and whether or not you think it's a good way to address rising carbon emissions. Stick around for the third part of the series, where we will address the costs and uncertainties with these strategies and pick which one is the most realistic. As always, the sources are linked in the description if you want to read more about GGR ideas. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe to support Planet Zero. I'll see you next time.